Welcome to the next lecture in electric circuit analysis. In this lecture, we are going to focus our discussion on voltage, power, energy, resistance, and Ohm's law. So first, let us see what is voltage. When we need to move the electron in a conductor in a particular direction, it will require some amount of work or energy. So, electron can be transferred from one point to another in a conductor with the help of a work or energy being done on the electron. This work is performed by an external source of EMF, which is known as the electromotive force, also known as the voltage or the potential difference. So, the different names by which the potential difference, voltage and EMF all will have the same meaning. The voltage between two points A and B in an electric circuit is the energy or work needed to move a unit charge from A to B. So if we want to move a charge from point A to point B, which is of unit charge, then the voltage is given by the rate of dW by dQ. So the voltage which is produced, or the potential difference between the two points A and B in an electric circuit, is particularly the work done with respect to the charge. So dW by dQ will give you the voltage. Now the unit of W, which is the energy, is in joule, whereas the unit of charge given by Q is in coulomb. It is evident from this equation, this 1 volt, that is the voltage 1 volt, will be equal to 1 joule by 1 coulomb. So 1 volt will be equal to 1 joule by 1 coulomb, and the joule can be written energy in terms of Newton meter. So we know that energy can be written in terms of force into distance. So energy is equal to force into distance. So 1 volt is equal to 1 joule per coulomb is equal to 1 Newton meter per coulomb. The voltage or potential difference is the energy required to move a unit charge through an element which is measured in volt. So this is the definition of the voltage. Voltage is particularly that amount of energy which will required to move a unit charge through an element, and the unit for the voltage is given in volts. So here we can see that we have a charge of 1 coulomb. So potential difference, which is the difference between the voltage between the two points, will be equal to 1 volt if 1 joule of energy is exchanged in moving 1 coulomb of charge between two points. So 1 coulomb of charge has to move from point X to point Y, then the energy required is 1 joule. In that case, the voltage is said to be 1 volt. Mathematically, if we see, then the voltage is given by W by Q. So W is basically the energy, the Q is basically the charge. Similarly, from this equation, we can obtain what is the value of W, that is the energy is equal to the product of the charge and the voltage. The unit of voltage is volts, the unit of energy is joules. Similarly, the charge is given as W by V. So from this equation, we can obtain what is Q, and the unit is in coulomb. So mathematically, we can find one quantity if the other two quantities are given to us. Now, the potential difference VAV between the two points is such a way that one point is at higher potential as compared to the other points. So three things has to be noted in a particular circuit. That is, we should be given the positive and the negative sign. We have to be given the voltage. So when we write that the voltage VAV, it means that it is equal to VA minus VB, where the reference can be taken with respect to ground. So you can take the ground as a reference when we are dealing with VA and VB. VAB means the potential difference between two points A and B. So this is the voltage VAB. Now the voltage VAB will be equal to minus of voltage of VBA. Means if we take the voltage of point B to be at higher potential as compared to the point A, then we can include a negative sign before. Like for example, here the A is at higher potential as compared to the B, so we have plus 9 volt. Now if we make the B to be at higher potential and A to be at lower potential and we measured with respect to A, then we can set this to be minus 9 volt. So VAB is equal to minus of VBA. The potential difference or voltage is always measured between two points in the system. So basically we require two points A and B to measure the potential difference, or which is known as the voltage. If isolated point is there, suppose a point A is there, then the other point will be with respect to ground, then only we can measure the potential difference V. Changing either point may change the potential difference between the two points under investigation. So if we are measuring the voltage between two points A and B, now one more point we have introduced, that is C. Now we try to measure the voltage VBC and VAB. So VAB and VBC will not be equal because we have changed the point of measurement. Like electric current, a constant voltage is called the DC voltage. So when we were discussing the electric current, we have discussed that when we have a constant magnitude of the current or the voltage, then it is known as the DC voltage. Whereas when we have a sinusoidally varying quantity, then it is known as the AC voltage or the alternating current voltage. A DC voltage is commonly produced by a battery. So when we have a battery, there the chemical energy is converted into electrical energy, and that is particularly a DC. Whereas an electric generator basically produces an AC voltage. So electric generator can be DC generator or AC generator. However, three phase AC generators, which is known as synchronous generator or the alternators, produce the AC voltage. Now having known the voltage, our topic of focus will be now on power and energy. So power is an indication of how much work can be done in a specified amount of time, that is a rate of doing work. So when we try to find the power, we are basically measuring the energy rate, and the conversion of energy from one form to another will result in the conversion of the power. So power is basically the time rate of expending or absorbing the energy, and it is measured in watt. So this is the unit of power. Now in the ahead discussion, we will divide that power can be of different terms. So when we say P, it is indicating the real power. When we indicate the Q, it is basically the reactive power. When we tell the S, it is basically the apparent power. So power can be of different names, but for a DC quantity where only resistance is involved, we will be dealing with only the real power. The unit of real power is watt. So when we say power or the real power, it means the same thing because our focus of discussion is only on DC. Now, the equation of power is mathematically can be given as the rate of work done. So the numerator we will be having the work or the energy, and on the denominator we will be having the time. It means the unit of power is 1 watt, which is equivalent to the rate of doing the work, means 1 joule per second. The bigger unit of power is given in horse power, which is equivalent to 746 watt. So generally in mathematical problems, we do not deal with a smaller unit rather than a bigger unit we select. So there we say it to be a horse power. So one horse power is equivalent to 746 watt. Now here we can say the power to be the rate of work done, that is dW by dt. Now dW by dt can be further broke down as dW by dq into dq by dt. So the dq dq term will be cancelled out and it will be again equal to dW by dt. Now dW by dq, we know that it is equal to the voltage, where and dq by dt is the current. So the power can be written as the product of the voltage and current from this equation. So power is equal to dW by dt. This can be broke down into dW by dq multiplied with dq by dt, because dq and dq can cancel out each other. So dW by dq can be written as the voltage and dq by dt can be written as the current. So power is the product of voltage and current. Now there is some passive sign convention which we have to obey in order to find the direction of the power, whether it is an absorbing power or it is a supplying power. If the power is supplying, it means it is a source. If the power is absorbing, it means it is a load. So when a voltage source, which is given by the positive and negative terminal, and the current is coming away from the positive terminal and entering the negative terminal, then the power is positive and given by P equal to plus VI. Whereas if the current source is coming input to the positive terminal, then the power is given by a negative sign, it is equal to minus of VI. So passive sign condition is satisfied when the current enters through the positive terminal of an element and there the power is plus VI. If the current enters through the negative terminal, then power is minus VI. So seeing the sign of the power, we can say whether the power is coming from the source or it is absorbing by the load. Now let us take one example where a circuit element is there. We do not know the circuit element, which is having a voltage of 4 volt with a positive sign and negative sign, and a current of 3 ampere is coming out of the positive source. The other circuit here, we have a negative at the first terminal and positive at the next terminal, and 3 ampere is entering the negative terminal. So both cases we will be having 12 watt as the absorbing power. So in both the cases, whereas on the other circuit, if we have a 4 volt source and a 3 ampere current source, which is entering the positive terminal and once coming from the out of the negative terminal, then here you can have a power of minus 12 watt. So power absorbed is equal to power supplied with a proper sign convention. Law of conservation of energy must be obeyed in any electric circuit. For any electric circuit, we need to obey the law of conservation of energy. For this reason, the algebraic sum of power in a circuit at an instant of time must be zero. So the summation of power in the entire circuit. So if we have a circuit which is closed with too many elements, then the sum of the power P1 plus P2 plus so on will be equal to zero, depending upon whether the power is absorbed or it is supplied. Thus, the total power supplied to the circuit must balance the total power absorbed. So, power supplied and power absorbed will be equal in the circuit. Energy absorbed or supplied by an element then can be given from the power equation as the energy W is basically the integral of the power over a time within a time frame, that is T0 to T. Now power can be written as the product of voltage into current. So integral of vi dt from t naught to t, where t naught is the initial time and t is the final time, will give the energy absorbed or supplied by an element. Energy is basically defined as the capacity to do work, and it is measured in joules. So the energy unit is in joules. The electric power utility companies generally measure energy in terms of watt hour. So 1 watt hour is equal to 3600 joule. So in order to pay the electricity bill, we try to measure the energy in terms of watt hour, which is equivalent to 3600 joule. Next topic of discussion will be what is resistance and what are the factors that affect the resistance. So the flow of charge through any material encounters an opposing force similar in many respects to mechanical friction. So we will have friction in the mechanical domain which obstruct the force. Similarly, in electric domain for a material, there will be an obstructing force which is known as the resistance. So resistance is the property of the material that obstruct the flow of the charge or the current. These opposition due to the collision between electrons and between electrons and other atom in the material, which converts electrical energy into another form of energy such as heat, is called the resistance of the material. So due to the resistive property of the material, there are collisions between the electrons and the atom which result in the production of heat in the material. The resistance of any material with a uniform cross-sectional area is determined by the four factors. So if we have a two-terminal element with a length L, area cross-section A, then the resistance is given by R is equal to rho L by A. So R is the resistance, L is the length, A is the area of cross-section, and rho is the resistivity. So inverse of resistivity is basically known as the conductivity. So conductivity is the inverse of resistivity. The unit of resistivity is given in ohm centimeters, length is given in centimeter, and A is given in area square centimeter. So the four factors which govern the resistance of any material is given by material, length, cross-sectional area, and temperature. Temperature is a very important factor which determines the resistance of any material. So resistance will depend upon the temperature which we will focus. So generally the resistance looks like this in generally, and it has two terminal device. So there are two terminals, 1 and 2, through which we can connect the other part of the circuit. The inverse of resistance is basically known as the conductance, whose unit is in Siemens, or otherwise we can write it as mho. So inverse of resistance will be given in mho as the conductance. So the resistance of a material will depend on the property called resistivity, denoted by rho. So rho is basically the resistivity of the material, which is material specific. So once we change the material, the value of resistivity will change. Let us take an example of a material whose resistivity is rho, length L, area of cross section A, and at a particular temperature T, and understand what factors affect the resistance. So if the resistivity of the material increases, the resistance will increase. This is because R is equal to rho L by A. So resistivity plays a very important role in affecting the resistance. So keeping the length and area same, if we increase the resistivity, obviously the resistance will increase. Similarly, if we increase the length, the resistance will increase. If we decrease the area of the cross section, the resistance will increase, because resistance, which is given by rho L by A, keeping the other factors constant, resistance is inversely proportional to the area of cross section. It means that if area is decreased, then resistance will increase. Now, temperature plays a very important role, as I said. So temperature increase, the resistance increase, and this is for different types of material, whether it is a conductor, insulator or semiconductor, that we are going to discuss ahead. Now let us take an example to understand how the resistance effect on these parameters. In all the cases, whatever we are going to discuss, A, B, C and D, are of different nature. In the first condition, we have taken two materials, copper and iron, of the same length and same area of cross-section. However, we know that the resistivity of iron is more than the resistivity of copper. This will result in R2 to be greater than R1. In the second case, we have taken both as the same material, but the length of L2 is greater than L1, then again we will be having R2 is more than R1. Third case, we take the same material, but the cross-sectional area of A2 is less than A1, then again we will be having R2 is more than R1. Fourth case, we are taking both as copper with the same length and cross-sectional area, but the temperature effect on the second is more than the first, so again we will have R2 greater than R1. So these factors, resistivity, length, area and temperature, plays a very important role in understanding the resistance effect. Let us see some common values of the resistivity of various materials. So we can see that silver, copper, gold, aluminium, tungsten, nickel, iron till carbon, the values of the resistivity. So in this table we can find that the resistivity, if we know that resistivity is more, than resistance is more, and the material behaves as an insulator. So generally we have materials can be a conductor, which can conduct electricity, it can be insulator, which obstruct electricity, or in between it can be a semiconductor. So if we compare the materials with different nature, that is copper, which is a conductor, and different semiconductor, that is germanium, silicon or gallium arsenide, and in general some insulator. So the value of the resistivity has to be more when it is an insulator, because the resistance will be more, then only the current will be less. So insulator resistivity has to be very high, whereas comparatively copper, which is a conductor, its resistivity has to be less, because then only the resistance will be less and the current flow will be more. So this table gives a data for the resistivity of different materials and how it affect the resistance. As I said, that the temperature plays a very important role in changing the resistance. So let us see the effect of temperature on different type of materials. First we will discuss the conductor, then we will move to semiconductors and insulators. For a good conductor, an increase in temperature will result in an increase in the resistive value. So once the temperature is increased, the resistance is increased. So consequently, we can say that for a conductor, it has a positive temperature coefficient. Whereas for a semiconductor, if it has to be a good material, increase in temperature will result in a decrease in the resistance value. So once you increase the resistance, once you increase the temperature, the resistance will decrease. Consequently, semiconductors have negative temperature coefficient. So we can see that conductors and semiconductors behave inversely to each other. The insulators behave similar nature to the semiconductors. It will have a negative temperature coefficient, that is, increase in temperature will result in decrease in the resistance of the insulator. So here we can see a graph between the resistance and the temperature. So it will have positive temperature coefficient when it is a conductor, and for a semiconductor or an insulator, it will have a negative temperature coefficient. Now, how do we determine the resistance of a material? So resistance, we know that it increases almost linearly with the increase in temperature for the conductor material. So the topic focus is on conducting material. So the resistance will increase linearly, means it will give a straight line relationship. When we are talking a graph between the resistance and temperature, we are having an almost linear relationship up to a certain range, after which it shows a non-linear relationship. So resistance increase almost linearly when we increase the temperature. Now it is important to determine the resistance at a particular temperature within operating limit. So once we change the temperature, resistance changes. So at a particular temperature, what is the value of resistance we have to determine. Now the actual curve of this straight line extends to absolute zero. So if we extend the curve, it will be at absolute zero, which is minus 273.15 or 0 Kelvin, and the straight line approximation is quite accurate. So when we go for the straight line approximation, then it coincides at minus 234.5 degrees centigrade, which is known as the inferred absolute zero. So if we apply the similar triangle rule, then we can get x by r1 is equal to y by r2. It means that we take a point of inferred absolute zero and we try to measure for the two temperature points T1 and T2, what is the distance between the absolute zero on the graph. So once distance we get x for T1 and another distance we get y for T2. And using the similar triangle rule, we can write x by r1 is equal to y by r2, where r1 is correspondingly to the temperature T1 and r2 is correspondingly to the temperature T2. Now we can write for the x, we can write 234.5 plus T1. We have not included the negative sign because we are just measuring the distance. So the distance is 234.5 plus T1. Here y distance is equal to 234.5 plus T2. So from this relationship, we can find the resistance of a material at a particular temperature. Having known the resistance, we will focus on Ohm's law now. So Ohm's law basically states that the voltage across a resistor is directly proportional to the current flowing through the resistor. So voltage will be proportional to the current when it is flowing through a resistor. The constant of proportionality that can be introduced is basically the resistance. So V is equal to I into R. So here we can replace this constant of proportionality with the resistance. Now let us take an example. We have a material whose resistance we need to find. We connect a battery of 1.5 volt into three panels, so it is 4.5 volt. So 1.5 into 3 will give you 4.5 volts. So the current which is flowing here on measurement, it gives to be 9 milliampere. And we know that V is equal to IR relationship will give the resistance is equal to voltage by current. So we have measured the voltage as 4.5 volt and the current we have measured as 9 milliampere, that is 9 to the 9 into 10 to the power minus 3. This will give to a resistance of 500 ohms. So we can measure the resistance of a material once we have measured the voltage and current across it. So resistance is basically the slope of the graph of the between the current and the voltage. So the change in the voltage delta V by delta I will give you the resistance of any material, which is the slope of the graph. So once delta V means what is the change in the potential, delta I means what is the change in the current. So we can find the resistance of any material with this law. Now if we revisit the power equation that we have defined earlier, is power is the product of voltage into current, and now we have introduced the Ohm's law as V is equal to I into R. So we can put the value of this current as V by R. from the relationship of the Ohm's law. So I is equal to V by R. This will give result as power is equal to V square by R. So this is the first formula for power, and the second formula is V equal to V square by R. On the other hand, instead of changing the current, if we put the voltage to be I into R, it means that we get one more formula for the power as P equal to I square R. So in some cases, we need to find what is the current when the power is given. So we can easily find with respect to power and the resistance. So I is equal to under root P by R. So these three formulas of power is important when we solve some type of numericals. Now we understand what is an open circuit and what is a short circuit. Let us focus on open circuit. Suppose a two terminal device is there, 1 and 2. The circuit element with resistance approaching infinity will result in the open circuit. So here, if the resistance is infinite, it means the current flowing through the circuit will be zero. Hence, that circuit is known as open circuit. Whereas, if we talk about the short circuit, here the resistance will be approaching zero. So if the resistance is approaching zero, we know that V is equal to I into R. It means that if resistance is zero, obviously the voltage will be zero and it will be known as the short circuit. So open circuit and short circuit will be there in the circuit when we will solve some type of problems. So the focus of this particular lecture was more on power, energy, resistance and Ohm's law. In the previous lecture, we have discussed on charge and the current. So both lecture 1B and 1C plays a very important role in understanding the fundamentals of electrical engineering. Thank you for now, and see you in the next lecture.